We prepared a slideshow of photos which might actually help understand what an ambitious project the Federal Assembly was. You may know that Czechoslovakia became a federation in 1968, and this building in the forefront, which is just next to the National Museum on the top of Wenceslas Square, was also designed in that, you know, reformist, progressivist, and very, very hopeful time. So I'll say a story of a parliament which was set up as an ambitious and hopeful institution, which lost all its sovereignty in the 1970s after the invasion of the Allied troops of the Warsaw Pact. Which was then sort of, you know, called back to some of the flashlights in the perestroika times in the late 1980s, when the parliament was supposed to become the floor for sort of showing the spirit of openness and was also a target of public pressure. And then, of course, experienced the Velvet Revolution and became one of the main cornerstones of the post-socialist transformation. Let me start with a methodological remark. You know, this is not only my work, this is a result of the work of our team, including Petr Robal and Tomáš Zahradníček. We're all working along the neo-institutionalist approach. While the traditional institutionalism or institutional approach in historiography would observe the most visible parts of Parliament and their documentation, and that would be the legislation parts, the official functionaries, the official actors, or the ways of founding the body, we are concentrating on something completely different. We're interested in the practices, habits, values, and myths that are accepted by this institution and that are further transferred. Maybe we are even more radical, because we even observed that in such a radical change of context as the regime change, between communism and what followed was, the institution doesn't adapt any immediately. We found a fluid institution, a vulnerable environment that constantly sought to find new balance between the existing rules and legal regulation, and the myths transferred, and the new actors coming in, and the previous members of MPs and their expectations and self-concepts and so on. So it's a very complicated and multifaceted picture that I will try to get through to you within 20 minutes or so. So once again, physically speaking, the Federal Assembly was situated right in the heart of the Velvet Revolution, because all of the demonstrations took place Wenceslas Square, and on top of the square, we had the building of Parliament. And yet, for many days, the Parliament was missing in the symbolic topography of the revolution. The reasons were manifold. First, the demonstration actually centered around the statue of St. Wenceslas, and that was separated from the parliamentary building by a busy crossroad and an urban motorway constructed in the late 70s. The original building did not count with that. Second, the demonstrators actually turned their attention to the Communist Party organs and to media headquarters, by which they assessed the parliament's significance in the political system quite appropriately. And third, the Federal Assembly did neither try to join the revolution, nor did it stand up openly to hold it back. Why was that? From the documents, it seemed that for almost 2 weeks following that famous police act against the student demonstration on the National Street, the life in the parliamentary building went on as if nothing was happening and no crowds of thousands were to be seen from the windows. The sessions of committees were held according to a yearly schedule passed in late 1988. It was dealing with bill drafts prepared by the government. And yet was there obviously a fierce fight inside of the Communist Party, exactly about should we join the revolution in a moderate way, try to manipulate it, or should we try to hold it back with the help of the military. And there was also an amazing fear in the revolutionary movement, the Civic Forum, that the parliament would actually become active and pass all the perestroika, the reformist legislation that was prepared by them. The fight did not come to a clear conclusion, and for almost 2 weeks, the socialist parliament seemed to, in fact, try to exemplify stability, expert knowledge, proper organization, and stay quiet. Let me explain what the socialist parliament concept actually means in our opinion. Parliaments occupied a very ambiguous position in state socialist systems. Of course, there was the theory and ideology, so let's say Marx's complete rejection of bourgeois parliaments, then Lenin's more pragmatic interpretation of this Marxist notion and focus on parliaments actually staying in but turning into these executive and legislative bodies at the same time. And there was the Stalinist guideline, which said, well, it actually has to be communist parties that are that control the parliaments. The Czechoslovak state socialism came to existence in 1948, so perfectly along the Stalinist guideline. It was in fact an infiltration of the existing National Assembly by the Communist Party and by its followers in other parties. But somehow it preserved the system and turned it into a new socialist parliamentary system. The composition of parliaments under socialism was no more derived purely from party electoral support. These assemblies, these bodies, needed to mirror the society in a more literal sense. The system of so-called descriptive representation produced parliament consisting of deputies who reflected the society's occupation, gender, ethnic, and age structure to a considerable extent. So you had a young female worker sitting there, you had a mid-aged chief of a cooperative farm sitting in the bottom, and so on. The system was also rejecting the whole concept of separation of executive, legislative, and judicial powers. A socialist parliament and so a socialist political system offered one unified power representing the working people. These working people were supposed to practice this power through the so-called representative structure. And this structure stretched from the national committees, sort of councils at the very bottom, at local and district levels, up to the parliament, even including the federal parliament. It was supposed to be a parallel to the Soviet system, system of Soviets of these councils, and I would very much like to hear that in comparison to the Yugoslav example, because I think that's very different here. But in the Czechoslovak example, the sort of old-fashioned words were kept. So the National Committee, the local Soviets were called the National Committees, which was a historical word, and the National Assembly remained to be called the National Assembly. The word parliament was not used, but the National Assembly was not called the highest, the supreme Soviet, as it would be in a proper Stalinist parliamentary system. But once again, this whole system of representation was very much transformed or included in the system of state administration and completely gave up the original self-governing principle. And that's what I was saying, it did not really happen in Yugoslavia with their workers' councils completely, but I want to hear a comment. This principle of representation, so a structure stretching from below up to the parliament, did not really change through the adoption of the so-called socialist constitution in 1960, and in fact not even through the federalization of 1968. Tomáš Zahradníček will talk about that in more detail, but formally the national level was sort of abolished. And there were two republics, the Czech and Slovak republics, with their own parliaments and governments, plus a federal level, a federal parliament, a federal government, and federal institutions set up in 1968. Only that much of the political system actually understood the federal level as a replacement of the former national level, and this federal aspect of the whole structure was of course diminished to something similar as compulsory figures that political actors had to practice on formally given occasions. This was perceived very differently on the Czech and Slovak side, and I'll stress this aspect from now on. But the general concept of representative structure remained the core of representative legitimacy until 1989. As a result, the Velvet Revolution encountered an established system of federal and sub-federal parliaments which had formally strong power, in fact were under complete control of the Communist Party. The revolutionary movement found itself next to a highly unpopular socialist parliament which they did not control. So once again, the revolutionary movement did not have control of the parliament. At the same time, because the Velvet Revolution was a peaceful, and as they said, articled one, that means things were supposed to happen in a legal way along the legal system, they desperately needed the parliament to pass the legislation. As a way out of gridlock, the revolutionary parliament was set up as an interim form between the socialist and liberal democratic parliaments. This is a chapter, technically, which Becker Rowell will describe, because in January 1990, that means 2 months after the original student strike, about half of all members of the parliament were replaced without an election. They either resigned or were deprived of their mandate according to a law that the parliament passed. And new MPs, who were supposed to provide better guarantees of developing political democracy, were co-opted by their remaining colleagues. The result was establishing a provisional revolutionary parliament with very specific characteristics. Until that moment, all important decisions were made at round tables, where the revolutionary forces, as well as the up-to-date communist negotiators, were represented. Almost none of these people had parliamentary seats. So only through co-opting, once again, which Petra will talk about in more detail, they got parliamentary mandates, and the decision-making could be transferred to the legislature. The parliament had been integrated into politics. But while the political actors, as well as the media, talked about the urgent tasks for epoch-making times, in reality, the parliament was given only a very limited mandate. The term was shortened to until June 1990, so there were only 3 or 4 months to work. And there were also explicit limits on the contents of their work. So they were supposed to pass the legislation that the Revolutionary Republic required from them, and such things as the new constitution, for example, were supposed to be left up to the next freely elected parliament. Because of co-opting and changing the composition of the parliament, this new body obviously did not match the previous system of representation in the sense of replicating the social structures. There was, for example, the over-representation of people from the central cities, so this whole territorial representation fell apart. But it was expected to represent the society in a different sense. By its voting, the revolutionary parliament was supposed to legalize the changes required by the revolutionary republic. The parliament was sort of supposed to pass over its own autonomy and serve the public good. At the same time, there were many moments at which the parliament was acting independently of the outside requirements. This is another chapter that my colleagues will later talk about, the so-called hyphen war, which was a battle for actually putting a hyphen inside the Czechoslovakia name of the state, was set up by Václav Havel, the president who stormed in the parliament and wanted his proposal to be quickly passed, but he wasn't aware of the context of the battle that was actually going on inside the parliament, and the parliament got blocked up against him. So somehow the parliament was not behaving according to everybody's expectation. The reason for this was that along with this revolutionary limited mandate, the parliament was also emancipating, and in spite of this provisional appearance, it was
in fact negotiating and establishing its new position within the political system. So until June 1990, this revolutionary parliament was in fact seeking a new relation with the president, to the federal government, to the Czech and Slovak national councils, and to the Czech and Slovak publics and the media. I'm stressing the plural here, Czech and Slovak publics, became really a different thing. The revolutionary parliament, as defined above, inhabited this difficult environment together with remnants of the socialist parliament and also with images and first attributes of the future liberal democratic one. So three parliaments sort of coexisted. Czechoslovak politics in 1990 had immense undertakings to do. It had to pass enormous amounts of legislation, build up political parties, find this new balance between political institutions without the Communist Party dominance, and maybe set up a non-destructive relationship with the media and many other tasks. And it did not have an established professional political class. Most of the political professionals from the socialist era have been discredited and replaced by new people. And parliaments became the main arena in which the professionalization of new political elites took place. Professionalism, in the sense of certain special skills and expert knowledge, was a factor that was present even in the socialist parliament. Its evaluators always talked about successful coordination of speeches, high quality of the sessions, and so on. So even the socialist parliament was supposed to look professional. The interviews of members of parliament, which we made, also show that this professionalism and expertise was a key element of their collective identity. For these people, the main disillusionment associated with the 1989 revolution was exactly the disruption of this professionalism, this chaos and lack of awareness of procedure and so on. Which is perfectly right, because continuity seemed really out of reach. Approximately half of the members of parliament were replaced in January 1990, and then the following June election brought three quarters of new people in the parliament. The question of formal professionalization was solved in summer 1990. Being a deputy became a regular paid job, but the salary approved was actually three times higher than the usual wage. This became one of the first income inequalities that the post-communist public was exposed to and caused a storm of criticism in the media. But while the public and the media expressed their expectations from the parliament to do a professional job for such a professional salary, there was a widely shared anti-professional ethic on the other hand. In this period, it seemed that in order to cut the link with the communist era, the political sphere needed people with no political experience, with no experience with leadership or legal education. That is, people who do not wish to become politicians but are willing to temporarily sacrifice themselves for the good of others. Similarly, as in case of other issues mentioned above, even in case of political professionalization, Czech and Slovak elites employed quite different and sometimes incompatible strategies. While the Czech post-socialist activists relied on the federal level to bring them a long-term political perspective, the Slovak leaders opted for sub-federal institutions of the Slovak Republic in Bratislava. For Slovaks, being kicked up to Prague was a risky thing. Because of the sessions in Prague, they grew isolated from Slovak politics, which is growing through a dramatic transformation. And also, the Czechs within the federal institutions felt alienated from their Slovak counterparts, who came over to the federal institutions to show constant dissatisfaction with its functioning, and to use, for example, the parliamentary procedure only pragmatically to push through their Slovak partial interests. The Czech members of parliament claimed they felt identified with the federal state. But in fact, what they were identified with, and I'm referring to Tomáš, who will explain this in more detail, was this Czech-dominated good old Czechoslovakia as set up in 1918 and in fact continuing
until 1989.
The tension between Czech and Slovak political representations of revolutionary republics could be felt from the very outset of the 1989 revolution. Soon, the Slovaks manifested that redistribution of powers between the federal and the republic's institutions was a primary issue of a democratic transformation. The Czechs, on the other hand, saw this as an obstacle to more urgent tasks of democratization and decolonization. A short surprise. But at least since the Hyphen War, it was obvious that a serious reform of the federal system, including a substantial redistribution of powers, would be necessary. One technical remark which I'll steal from Tomáš's speech is that the parliament did consist of two chambers. One of them, in one of them, there was a proportionate representation of the Czechs and Slovaks, so Czech majority and Slovak minority, and the other, the Chamber of Nations, was actually half Czechs, half Slovaks. And the system went as far as that some important decisions could not be approved without the approval of both the Czech and Slovak side of this one chamber. And therefore, half of the Slovak chamber, or half of the Czech, could have blocked any important decision. So the important federalization issues were left up to the parliament elected in 1990. This was the legislation which was supposed to have the legitimacy to draft a new constitution for both nations and the federation in the new era. But this existing federal system, which was originally created only to formally express the equality between the Czechs and Slovaks, but have in fact never been tested in an open political competition, could not stand this practice. The new Federal Assembly developed very sophisticated processes of constitution making and its negotiating with the publics. But these proposals were never shared by both national political communities. What were the reasons? So first of all, there was this complicated procedure which couldn't stand a democratic competition. Second, the parliament was doing many things at one time. So for example, it was simultaneously emancipate from other institutions and negotiate its new position in the political system. There was also the rebuilding of the party political spectrum going on. And last but not least, there was this professionalization of new political elites involving different strategies in the Czech and Slovak elites. As a result, the Federal Assembly in fact remained isolated from Slovak politics, and these prolonged negotiations on the parliamentary soil and elsewhere, partly mediated by President Havel whatsoever, in fact developed allergic reactions on both sides. The new constitution was never adopted, and the Constituent Assembly elected in 1990 was probably the only one that never adopted a constitution. And even the Czechoslovak bargaining led to no conclusion. The next election took place in 1992. It witnessed a professional campaign and produced stable political factions and a parliament with self-confident and professionalized members. It's interesting that this assembly, it's understandable that this assembly did not include major Slovak leaders such as Vladimír Mečiar, but it did not even include some of the more foresighted Czech leaders such as Václav Klaus, who ran for a seat in the Czech National Council. The federal parliament found itself to be the only remaining federal institution in an ever more fractured Czechoslovakia. In between, a deal between the new election winners in the Czech Klaus and Slovak Mečiar was made. And so the Federal Assembly turned out to be also the only institution that could once again legalize this deal that had been decided and made elsewhere. The deal included the dissolution of the Czechoslovak Federation, including the dissolution of the parliament itself. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Adela. Thank you very much, Peter, for a nice presentation of pictures. I like them very much. So please, come. comments, suggestions, ideas. I have written down one page, but I need it both to go ahead.
Since I need to go back right now because of other obligations, I would really like to invite you to our deputy group after you finish with your presentation. If this is not too political.
No, of course not.
But back to my mission of academics. I like your emphasis on professionalism. And I would like to, if it is possible, to elaborate a little bit more about this professionalism. How do you see and assess this need of professionalism in politics, in parliamentary arena?
Usually you say that, sociology says that it's the professionalization is the assimilation of the standards and values prevalent in a given profession. So somehow you have to subject to that, hear yourself by a perfect example, when turning from an academic to a politician, you obviously, lose something and have to adapt. The era that I'm talking about, and then you get the status, the money, the power that being a politician actually includes. And I was talking about a different era. So somehow there was a pressure because you can't expect a parliament to actually act in a parliamentary without having this professionalism. And at the same time, there was this pressure on people actually not doing that. So, once again, you certainly also have the images of the new politicians wearing sweaters and not office suits and all that stuff. And somehow that was supported, and this support was prolonged by at least the Czech public very strongly. Once again, this was different in Slovakia, where the separation of the socialist elites was not so dramatic. In the Czech lands, because of all the purges after 1968, where, for example, no reasonable non-communists could have stayed at academic institutes. And this is different in Slovakia. So there I would say, but maybe you'll have a comment on that. The gap between the socialist and revolutionary elites was not so big as in the Czech lands. So this pressure on anti-professionalism is very strong in the Czech environment. It was very much supported by Václav Havel, who exactly said, this is a temporary solution, and he didn't comment on who the professional politicians should be, but certainly not us, the new leaders, who do not decide that.
Would you correlate this need or strive for professionalism with the more general political culture or attitude of people towards politics and expectations that they have towards it?
Well, I can only say that for the Czech case, which I have sort of thought about. That is a tradition of this anti-political thinking in the Czech environment. So this whole alienation from the Austrian Empire and the substituting with cultural institutions and cultural activity instead of the political representation, that's an old and traditional thing. And I would say that the Czechs, the whole Czech dissident culture very much supported that. So yes, it's certainly a wider, longer issue and all that. The Slovak example is also very interesting. This much smaller alienation of the socialist and non-communist activists or elites in the Slovak environment, and very different consequences for building up the new public. For example, former members of the communist parties were much earlier to join the new political institutions in Slovakia than in the Czech Republic, where it seems sort of unacceptable.
Thank you.
I may add, we have among us two active politicians actually. One is Simona and the other is Adela. On my level of professionals. You both know what you're talking about, obviously. Please. I have one technicality. You mentioned neo-institutionalist approach. Can you explain a little bit more? Which concept did you follow and based on which sources? Then I'm on you.
I work with the, I mean, it's based on the, you know, classical texts of Walter Powell or Paul DiMaggio, but I would say that we radicalized it together, you know, with the amounts of material that we had. Not to think about these institutions as so strong. Somehow we found weaker institutions that were much more floating, you know, that we, what they used to be, what they were asked to be at the moment and what they wished to be one day. And that's this concept of the three parliaments coexisting, the social as well as a burden, but also a source of stability. And the current revolutionary parliament really intentionally constructed for a critical situation between socialist parliament and elections, and then this dream of a liberal democratic parliament, what it would be, how legitimate this would be, and so on.
How about the legitimacy? I mentioned also the parliament wasn't acted upon expectations until November 1989. What about, can you say a little bit more about expectations? Did the people express any concrete expectations between November 89 and summer regarding parliament, parliamentary system?
Well, very much so, but somehow it certainly was not supposed to be a sovereign, emancipated parliament. Well, publics never want that. They always want parliament to become their representation, which never happens. But in this case, there was this huge disillusion with the socialist parliament, and then the, you know, just limited power of the interim revolutionary parliament. So this is certainly not supposed to be any sovereign, and it was supposed to represent this new national unity, which was, you know, very carefully built, including the communists, and somehow the things that were happening there were I mean the. Emancipated and sovereign things were unacceptable for the Republic. Somehow it was supposed to legalize the will, the revolutionary will, and then only the newly elected parliament will be the one with the legitimacy.
And the newly elected parliament will have the legitimacy.
Yes, yes. Only that the people elected were elected on certain, you know, electoral lists, which still exist within 2 or 3 months. So the parliament started to sort of, you know, restructure politically life, you know, on TV screens. So you elected candidates of a certain party or movement, revolutionary movement, which ceased to exist, and it broke into parties, and your MPs became members of completely new parties, stressing completely different agendas that you elected them for. So once again, people could not be happy with such a parliament because it was changing in real time.
So the electoral campaign was quite short and unclear?
Well, it was very clear because it was this simple revolutionary campaign. So it was, I come in with us, you know, we don't play political parties, vote for Civic Forum. It got over 50% in the Czech lands. And then the Civic Forum broke up during the autumn following the elections.
The same as in Sweden.
Sounds familiar.
Any other questions?
By the way, many thanks for the pictures. They're very, very, very nice. Yeah. But I thought very impressive was this, how you described how representation in socialist regimes was thought about, like Marxist, the Leninist, the Stalinist view of it, and then how it developed basically in Czechoslovakia. And it's really interesting what happened basically at this cutting point in the 80s, so like, where basically having these parallels of, you know, like having you say, I'm a political scientist by training, so I'm not so much into contemporary history, though of course these are the past we're looking at. But in a way it seems that this past breaks were really made the way free for executive drift in a way. So, and we can ask, oh, even looking back at the history of parliamentarism in Eastern Europe, so was there any, you know, tradition of parliamentarism, a real one? Maybe, and probably the Czech Republic would be the best case where there was something of that. But in all the other countries, I mean, look at the Habsburg, you know, tradition, or like all these countries in there, and then also the Marxist, whatever tradition. But in a way, there was a real space for parliamentarianism, and there was the point to that in the early 90s, this you know, like upheaval and then the euphoria of parliaments, but then basically we just got back to where we were. So basically now parliament's not really playing a role. It was maybe a historical window of opportunity in a way that you know for you know launching the new elites into executive positions. But mainly talk about like what we see now, and certainly strengthened by you know European integration and all these things. There is a certain executive drift away from parliament towards, you know, executives. And this is, in a way, it was really interesting to see how this was already back then, sort of the historical roots of this. I'm not sure whether you sort of see that continuity. It's probably way too long, but I'm more mostly looking at, you know, like what happens now and, you know, parliament executive legislative relations, and then to find that this is, you know, basically going. So there is no real room for parliamentarianism, and probably not even a demand.
Well, there certainly was an important dream of the traditional, wonderful parliament that was supposed to exist in the interwar Czechoslovakia. So even after 1989, people were sort of thinking that the new parliament now, without the communists, would go back to that tradition. And of course, without understanding that, you know, for example, there were mandates bound to political parties, so MPs were not autonomous figures at all, that the president was manipulating the system through, you know, a control body consisting of the leaders of the political parties and so on. They were not aware of also the quality of the debate, for example. Until today, you will say, like, oh, never did we have, you know, such horribly uncultivated and indecent MPs. Oh, go back to the interwar Czechoslovakia. And of course you had Klement Gottwald, the communist leader, who was threatening, you know, the MPs during the sessions. And so there were fierce debates as well. Yes, the style is different, but I don't really think that there was any golden age of parliamentarism in interwar Czechoslovakia. But it was an important motif. So complaining of contemporary parliaments and referring to the interwar one was very strong. But once again, I would say in the Czech debate. This is a Czech position with Czechs, where the owners of interwar Czechoslovakia, they loved it and controlled it. The Slovak debate is completely different. And their approach to parliamentarism was much more pragmatic. Parliament is something, fellow power is something where you can get more powers for Slovakia. Maybe I ask you and your colleagues here, how about the self-governing principle in Yugoslavia? My thesis was the Czechoslovak socialist representative structure completely gave up for what about designed, you know, to keep any self-governing notion in the representative system, Soviet-like system.
Before September, November.
Yes. Was Yugoslavia any different? Was the, you know, at least in rhetorics, was the self-governing principle?
Of course, it was based on self-governing principle in rhetorics. I'll explain this a little bit more in a bit. Maybe leave this for now. Any other questions? Yes. Comments. Thank you very much,
Madam.
Really, I think all enjoyed.
And I want to say I'm really happy you like the pictures, because if you show this to Czechs, to Prague people, they would say, oh, this scar on the face of Prague.
What is the building in Prague?
What is the building? It's a part of the National Museum. There was also one photo with the Radio Free Europe sign. So in the 1990s, Václav Havel actually made a deal with Radio Free Europe and hired it for 1 crown per year. So for 7 years, Radio Free Europe had its headquarters in the building.
But not anymore. So where did they go now?
They have a new building in New York with more security, yes.
What is that with building from the Czech National Parliament?
The Czech National Council, that's the Council of the Chamber of Deputies, the Czech Parliament, the Lord Chamber. And in the Lesser Town, on the other side of the river, there's a parliamentary quarter, sort of. This building also, and some of the photos could show that it was supposed to be the same level as the Prague Castle. It was supposed to counterbalance the Prague Castle, really ambitious.